Okay, I think it's now recording to my device.
Sounds good.
You see the flag? You do? Okay. We are looking for Ralph and a few other people who I know are intending to join the meeting. We'll give it a few more minutes. Tilly, I think you're there. You're muted at the moment.
I'm here.
Yep. Okay. And do you have a copy of the resolution regarding the senior exemptions?
Yes.
Okay. I may ask you to read that.
Okay.
Ralph was having a little problem getting onto Zoom earlier this evening, so I hope he will be successful.
Are you expecting Lana
Morrison? No, we're not.
Okay.
John, if you could give Ralph a call.
Yeah, I'm going to do that.
See if you can help him.
Hi, Chris.
Hey, Warren. We're just waiting to see if we can get Ralph Fedeli with us. Lana Morrison will not be joining the meeting tonight. Thank you.
Chris, do you see Ralph in the waiting room?
I do not.
Okay, I'm
Did she just answer that, Walter? Did she just answer that question?
If people could mute themselves, that would be great.
Sorry, Chris.
No problem.
Watching Jeopardy till the meeting starts.
All right, we're about to go. Ralph is there.
Chris, do you see Ralph? All right, you should be good, Ralph.
Looks like Ralph is there. I can see Ralph's camera. So hopefully he is on. Okay, I think Ralph is there. I see Ralph. And with that, we will get going.
All right.
Okay, if everyone except the board could please mute themselves, that would be great. I would like to call this meeting of the town board of the town of Northeast to order. It's a virtual meeting on Zoom, as was previously announced. And I would like to begin with a Pledge of Allegiance to the flag, which hopefully you can see on your screen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Justice.
All right. I'm going to get rid of this little thing. I'm going to stop. Tilly, could you please conduct a roll call?
Yes. Supervisor Kennan?
Here.
Councilman Fedale?
Here.
Councilman Midwood?
Here.
Councilwoman Morrison? Councilman Cooper?
Here.
Okay, thank you. An agenda was distributed. This is the agenda that was posted. I made one change to it today to add a report from the broadband committee, but otherwise it is the same agenda that was posted. I would like to ask for a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you. And
can you ask for nays just so that I can?
Sure. Was anybody a nay on the motion to approve the agenda? No.
Nay.
If people could mute themselves except for the board, it would probably be helpful.
Okay.
Okay. One of the rules of the procedure which the town used to have as part of its rules of procedure was that we had a public comment period in the beginning on agenda items only. And it was pointed out to me that that was still part of our rules of procedure. So there will be two public comment periods going forward. One right in the beginning on agenda items only, and then a general public comment period towards the end on anything else. So are there any, is there any public comment on agenda items only? Hearing none, I have some comments to make. Welcome to the first regular town board meeting of the year. And once again, welcome to Griff Cooper. We look forward to actually seeing him in person at a future meeting and to getting him engaged in the work of the town board. We have a short agenda for tonight, but a few things that I would like to mention. Let me start with everybody's least favorite topic, COVID-19. The numbers in Dutchess County are off the charts, as people have probably are well aware. Positivity rates from testing really no longer mean anything because of all of the at-home tests, and those tests are generally not reported to the county, so that is a pretty meaningless number. But the number of cases in the county is very, very high. Hopefully it is peaking or will soon, and what we're hearing from the media is an expectation that those numbers will start to come down in later in January and in February. We certainly hope so. Speaking of COVID, the town has received two installments of at-home test kits from New York State via Dutchess County to be distributed without charge to our residents. We received 40 in the first batch and 80 in the second batch. I worked with the village, which has its own allotment, and Mayor Nydeck and Village Clerk Kelly Kilmer, and I gave them all out at Village Hall and then at the American Legion. And I would note that there was a misprint in the paper saying that that it was Deputy Mayor who had been giving them out at the Legion, but I know it was Kelly. I would like to thank the Legion and especially George Lind and Sean Clay for their help in that distribution. We understand that more test kits are coming our way, but we have not heard, at least as of right now, as to when they will be delivered. It could be very early next week, and we will let people know when we hear. Town hall is still open to the public, but by appointment only at the moment. And we look forward to when that can change. The town has an emergency operations plan. It's part of something that we are mandated to have. It was last updated in 2018. A village trustee, Josh Schultz, and I worked on updating it, but we never finished that because of COVID. And it is something that we should be working to complete. And I'm looking forward to working on that with the village. We've been talking about the wastewater district. At a recent meeting, we approved a proposal from Tie and Bond Engineers on producing a map plan and report, which is a very cumbersome name for something that is required, on a proposed wastewater district in the town, focused mainly on the Boulevard Route 44 area. Tie and Bond are still working on getting some revised cost estimates for the actual treatment plant, which, as people who have been following this know, would be in the village. We need those numbers before we can begin to speak with owners of parcels in the proposed wastewater district. A key question will be whether the district should extend only as far as Kelsey Brook, or whether, preferably in my mind, it should extend all the way to the Connecticut border into what we are calling Boulevard East, This is something I hope to discuss with the planning board and with the zoning review committee in coming time. With that, I would note our department and committee reports. I did receive a report from Chief Veeder, a police report late this afternoon. I have distributed it to the board and it will be posted on the town's website. We've had a glitch in getting them onto the website in the past few months, but I can promise you that they are going to be there and promptly. In terms of highway, Bob Stevens, I think you're on.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Could you give us a report on from the highway department?
Sure. Everything's going well with the highway department. We're currently working on equipment. All the equipment's holding up fairly well at this point. We have plenty of sand and salt in stock, and we're ready for anything Mother Nature sends our way.
It could be this weekend.
Possibly.
One of the things which we are working on, as people know, is we are looking forward to going out to bid on the last phase of the highway garage. And one of the very first things that we did today in conjunction with our engineers is to look at the site where the building will be built to see what the presence of bedrock is there. And Bob, I know you were there. Can you tell me how much bedrock you encountered?
We did not encounter any bedrock. We dug six test pits and everything was very good digging and no bedrock was encountered.
Well, that's very good news. We're looking forward to putting this building out to bid at the very end of the month or early days in February. Town Assessor, Catherine, do you have anything you want to give us at this point?
My only topic is an agenda item, so I'll pop in later.
Okay, thank you. The board received reports from the Planning, Zoning, and Building Departments. In terms of town board committee activity, do we have a report from the Police Committee, Ralph?
Yes. Okay. The committee met on January 6th, and we made some progress. We discussed the response times when there's a 911 call. The response times, of course, depend upon where either the trooper or the sheriff is, but the response times from Amenia would be 17 minutes and maximum response time 25 minutes from the state troopers. We did discuss the cost of police services. We discussed the $26,500 from the town and the town's contribution to the village. We did receive some comments from the residents, and of particular note, I thought that Daniel Goldhagen did a terrific job. He gave us some good information on local police in neighboring villages and towns in Dutchess County. I thought that was very helpful. And then, of course, we received some good input from Bill Kish, and we'll probably see an improvement in the monthly police reports by using the May report. Bill Kish did mention that the May 2021 report had information on that was constructive and worthwhile, and we're going to go that way. We are working on a schedule for a future meeting. And then we're also working on a mission statement for police services. At the very beginning of the January 6th meeting, I did give some historical information about how police services developed in Millerton years ago. And I thought that that would be helpful for people to understand how we got our own police department. So I think we've made some progress with the last report, and looking forward to meeting with anyone in the village who would like to contact me. I'm sure Lana is the same thing. We want to hear from you, and we'll also be available at the next Police Services Committee. That's it.
Great, Ralph. Thank you. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I am talking on behalf of the Highway Committee, and we just talked about the highway and the anticipation of going out to bid on the new building at the end of the month. I don't think there's any more information on that. That enables us to get now to our broadband committee report. The town formed a broadband committee some time ago, and Rich Stalzer and Claire Goodman, Andrew Stamen have been working hard on a broadband report, because as many people know, not everybody has access to the internet as much as we would like. So Rich and his committee actually finished a report on their work at the end of last year. And I'm glad that Rich is with us and able to sort of fill us in a little bit on the landscape of where we are with broadband service, not just in Northeast, but maybe in Dutchess County in general. Rich, it's all yours.
Okay, thank you. And I have a few slides, so could I get the screen share?
We can try this. This could be, let's see what happens. Nope, let's go back. Let's not do that. Okay, you should be able to share something on your screen.
Awesome, thank you. Share and slideshow. Okay, so thank you. Good evening, I'm Rich Stalzer, chair of the Town Broadband Access Advisory Committee. We were formed last year to study broadband in the town and village. Where is it available? Is it adequate, and how affordable is it for our residents? And our first action was to complete a community survey, which we did last November. And I hope everybody received that, if not earlier than today. So just a reminder, broadband is any kind of high-speed internet connection. The FCC defines it as 25 megabits of speed with 3 megabits upload. But we're going to use a criteria of 100 megabits, since that should allow for multiple people streaming video or gaming or video conferencing or doing distance learning at the same time. Just general cable internet qualifies as broadband. DSL or satellite typically do not. Okay, so what we did, we created an online and paper survey in English and in Spanish. It was distributed through town mailing lists, library mailing lists, NECC, mailing list, Vivitoc School District, flyers in local businesses, and paper copies at the library. We received 175 responses, 106 from our town, 53 from the village, and 16 from neighboring communities we didn't include in our results in this report. And here's a map showing where which addresses sent in a survey. And the colored dots mean something, but you can see there's a huge cluster in the village and along some major roads, but there's a lot of area on this town map that are no dots, which means we have no idea. The dots mean something. All those gray dots are cable internet. There's a few green ones in there that are fiber. DSL or satellite are red, and cellular is yellow, and a few black ones are no internet, either because they have no options or they chose not to or they can't afford it. But we're concentrating on wired internet because you need wires to get high speed. So highlighting this picture, and all these slides are extracted from the report. So when if you go read the report, you'll see all these maps in it and a lot of more granular information than what I'm presenting here. But here we have 8 dots where people said they had no internet. 11 dots. 11 people had no internet, mostly because it was too expensive, but some also had no options at their address or they were too slow. And the survey allowed for multiple. I'm concentrating on the 8 who claimed they had no access to wired internet. And I can tell you, like, the one on 22 probably does. You know, it's misreporting probably. But in the lower right corner around the Reagan and Sheffield roads, I did drive down there and confirm there are no wires up on the utility poles for internet. That corner of the town has a problem. And there are people who reported they're using DSL or satellite. And again, these are highlighted, the white bubble around the red dots. And again, I can tell you a lot of these have other options, but either, don't know about it or, DSL might be cheaper and they're staying on it, especially in the village. There's no reason why someone in the village can't get cable service. But, satellite is what's being used in the southeast corner, near Reagan and Sheffield. Because that's how they get their TV. Areas near the Pine Plains, we don't have a lot of results there, but we do know from the Pine Plains did a similar survey, and they found that their residents along our border had trouble getting cable internet service. So I expect there's some more problem areas there that we don't know about from our survey. And you see west of 22 and south, there's very little in terms of survey results. So while we tried, our responses are a little bit limited. So we can't say with confidence where these problems are. I can tell you that about 5% of the respondents said they could not get wired internet. And when we were talking to Weebatuck, they reported similar percentage of their families had no internet. And when they went to distance learning only, they purchased cellular modems, hotspots to give those families. So 5% seems to be a number around here for people who don't have any access to internet. Other findings, many residents are not happy with the speed of the service or its cost. I mean, more breakdowns are in the report, but I guess that shouldn't surprise anybody. We found very few locations where people thought they had fiber service, and fiber will be the future as the speeds get higher. It's a lot of the town is good enough for now with the cable-based internet service, but you know, fiber's better, and it's not a Northeast, basically. And just to wrap this up, Dutchess County has retained a consulting firm to try to determine countywide where there are areas without broadband. And they're doing the same thing we did. They created a resident survey, and they're hoping that people will fill it out. They're also trying, since they're bigger than us, they're hoping that they have the clout to get detailed coverage information from the internet companies like Altice. But tell you that they're very tight with that data, and New York State hasn't been able to get it, so I don't think Dutchess County is going to be able to get it. And more recently, New York State also launched a survey on resident internet, trying to figure out the same thing. So there's a lot of surveys out there. We did ours. What I found interesting is Columbia County EDC hired a consultant to determine every address within Columbia without high-speed internet. And that consultant drove every road and looked at the poles and mapped out where they saw no service. And where they did find service, they made a note of who was on that pole. They completed and published that survey. So Columbia has a good picture of what they're doing. They're way ahead of Dutchess. We, Chris, I, Andrew, recently met with this firm, and they offered to do the same thing for the town of Northeast for $4,000. So that would get us a list of every address within Northeast and Millerton that has no access to broadband. And I encourage the board to consider that expenditure, since that would put us in the enviable position of actually knowing where we have problems ahead of Dutchess County, if they ever get to this point. And the impetus for this is that the infrastructure plan, the Build Back Better program, earmarked $65 billion to help fill in the gaps by wiring communities that don't have internet right now. So if we knew where our addresses, the addresses where we don't have service, we could go to LTs or something and say, you know, we're not asking you to do the work. We already know, you know, these seven addresses down this road and these four over here, can we go to the federal government and get their money to cover the cost of running wires down these blocks? So that is the next recommendation. That is the recommendation that's coming out of our study. A few other things you'll find in that report. There's a page on, since affordability was such a big thing, there's a page on programs to do low-cost internet. Primarily, they're needs-based or income-based. But there is one anybody who wants to and isn't a current customer can get a low-cost plan. So, yeah, we did address the affordable issues. And that's my remarks.
Great. Thank you, Rich. I think this is very helpful for the town. And I think that the company that did the work in Columbia County of actually driving down every road and looking at every telephone pole to see what wires were on the pole is more, much more robust and granular than a survey. As we all know, we get surveyed a lot, and sometimes we feel like filling out a survey and sometimes we don't. I think we got a really good sort of baseline of information on where we are. People need access to the internet, and they've needed it. They certainly needed it during this period of COVID. Children who were unable to be in school and were learning remotely had very varied access, and in many cases, no access to the internet, or if there were multiple kids in the house all trying to get on at the same time, very intermittent access. So, so many things we are dependent on for the internet. I do intend to talk with the board, and we want to take a good look at this proposal because if we did have that information, I know we would be ahead of, I think, pretty much every other town in Dutchess County. So that would put us in a very good spot. So we will be getting back to you, Rich, and to the committee. But I really appreciate the work that the committee has done. It was, there was a lot of work that was involved in assembling that information. Rich, can we put that report onto the website?
Well, you can, yes.
Right. Well, I would like to, as I know that people will find it interesting to look and see where, you know, where service appeared to be better than, you know, other places. So we will certainly plan to do that, and look forward to hearing where this goes and what we can do to enhance our broadband access.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Rich.
You're welcome.
Are there any questions from the board for Rich at this point?
If I could, just quickly, Rich, I had a chance to scan your report.
Okay, is that Griff?
It's me, yep.
Yeah, if you can speak up a little bit, it'd be great.
Sure thing. Yeah, I wanted to just, in Rich's opinion, how viable is a municipal fiber network? You mentioned in the report that you and Chris had met with Ankrum, and that this proposal was something that had been discussed a year ago.
Yeah, I think it makes more sense for communities that are like Ankrum that are still mostly DSL, because most people do not have something that they're paying for right now that meets their needs. But since 90% of the people who completed the survey said that they had access to cable internet, you know, it's hard to say we're going to somehow use taxpayer money to build out a fiber network that will probably cost more than what you're paying for cable. It might be better for you in the future, but you know, the numbers are higher. We did talk to Mount Washington, Massachusetts, who did do it because they had no cable service. So it made sense for them, and they got a lot of state funding. And you know, their subscribers are paying about $150 a month for internet. Now that seems pretty high compared to what people are reporting that they're paying for cable internet here.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Rich.
Sure.
All right. Thank you very much. The next item on the agenda is resolution regarding the senior exemption request. I could try to explain it, but I know that Catherine can do it much better than I can. So, Catherine, if you could tell us in briefly how this works, that'd be great.
This is similar to what happened last year. Governor Hochul proposed last month, considering two things: the fact that the exemption deadline by law is March 1st, and that the COVID-19 numbers were increasing and it seemed to be getting out of control. She wanted to make sure the seniors wouldn't be locked out of getting an exemption because they were either afraid or unable to get their exemptions completed and submitted to my office in time because of the time period. So she proposed, as similar to last year, she made an executive order that allowed towns to make a resolution to allow seniors the ability to not have to submit an application this year, and they will just automatically receive the same exemption amount that they received last year. So it's just basically continuing what they've already had without the requirement, the by law requirement to do an annual renewal application. So this was proposed, and obviously we have a significant number of low-income seniors that benefit from the program, and it would be a benefit for them not to have to worry about exposing themselves and putting themselves in danger for their health in order to maintain this exemption. And so that's basically what the resolution does. And hopefully you all agree that this would be a benefit to our seniors in our community.
So in as I understand it, Catherine, in essence, this resolution permits you, where you know, where you are aware that there's actually been a change in ownership or something like that, to make that inquiry?
Yes. If I know, and there are a number of seniors who either passed away, sold their properties, you know, situations where we know that they shouldn't get the exemption that they got last year, I'm able to take the steps to make sure that that doesn't happen. But otherwise, every senior that had the same situation as they have in the past would continue to have the same exemption.
So I think that this is a resolution which makes sense for us. And I would like to ask Town Clerk Tilly Strauss to, if you would, to read the resolution.
Sure. Okay. Resolution directing the town assessor to grant senior citizen exemptions on the 2022 assessment roll in accordance with Executive Order Number 11.1. Whereas on December 26, 2021, Governor Kathy Hochul issued Executive Order Number 11, declaring a state disaster emergency for the entire state of New York due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And whereas this state disaster emergency has resulted in limited hours in municipal offices in the town of Northeast and rendered senior citizens and individuals with disabilities residing in Northeast homebound. These factors combined have made it difficult, if not impossible, for many of these populations to file their real property tax exemption applications in person, and many further lack the ability to file such an application online. And whereas in recognition of the above problems caused by the pandemic, Governor Hochul issued Executive Order Number 11.1 on December 26, 2021, thereby extending Executive Order Number 11. This extension of the governor's executive order modifies subdivision 7, 7A and 8 of section 459C of the real property tax law and subdivisions 5, 5A, 5B, 5C and 6 of section 467 of real property tax law, the effect of which permits the governing body of the assessing unit, i.e. the town board of the town of Northeast, to adopt the resolution, a resolution directing the assessor to grant exemptions on the 2022 assessment roll to all property owners who received such exemptions on the 2021 assessment roll, i.e. senior citizens and individuals with disabilities with limited income, thereby dispensing with the need for such persons to file renewal applications to request such exemptions, and further dispensing with the requirement that assessors mail renewal applications to such persons. And whereas Executive Order 11.1 further allows the governing body of said assessing unit in any such resolution at its option to include procedures by which its town assessor may require a renewal application to be filed if she has reason to believe that an owner who qualified for the exemption on the 2021 assessment roll may have since changed his or her primary residence, added another owner to the deed, transferred the property to a new owner, or died. And whereas pursuant to said executive order, the town board of the town of Northeast wishes to adopt such resolution directing the town assessor of the town of Northeast to grant exemptions on the 2022 assessment roll to all eligible senior citizens and individuals with disabilities with limited income, and granting the town assessor of the town of Northeast the authority to require renewal applications for due cause as discussed above, utilizing procedures outlined below. Now, therefore, be it resolved, pursuant to the authority granted by Executive Order Number 11.1 issued by the Governor of the State of New York, that the Town Board of the Town of Northeast hereby directs the Town Assessor of the Town of Northeast to, one, grant exemptions on the 2022 assessment roll to all individuals who received the senior exemption on the 2021 assessment roll, and all individuals who received the exemption on the 2021 assessment roll because they were recognized as a person with disabilities and limited income, thereby dispensing with the need for any such individuals to file renewal applications for such exemptions, except that, two, the town assessor may, in his or her sole discretion, require a renewal application to be timely filed with his or her office if he or she has reason to believe that any such individual who qualified for the aforementioned exemption on the 2021 assessment roll may have since changed their primary residence, added another owner to the deed for the relevant property, transferred such property to a new owner, or died. If the town assessor requires such renewal application to be filed, she shall notify the owner of the subject property of such requirement by regular mail with such notice, which with such notice shall contain instructions on how to file the renewal application. Said renewal application may be returned by mail or by making an appointment to drop off same off at the town assessor's office, 19 North Maple Avenue, Millerton, New York, 12546.
Great. Thank you very much. If there are any comments from the board, that would be welcome, or I would entertain a motion to approve the resolution.
I'll move. Second.
I think that was a motion by Ralph and a second by Griff Cooper. Tilly, could you conduct a roll call?
Yes. Supervisor Cannon?
Aye.
Councilman Fedeli?
Aye.
Councilman Midwood?
Aye.
Councilman Cooper?
Aye.
Okay, the resolution is approved. Thank you. The next item is the standard workday and reporting resolution. This is something that is filed with the state, and it was distributed to the town board. And I need a motion to acknowledge that it was distributed and received by the town board.
So moved.
Motion by John Midwood, seconded by Ralph. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Nay. Motion is approved. We now have a public comment period. If there's anybody in the public who would like to comment, please let me know.
Just have one quick little comment.
Yes.
Regarding the resolution that just passed, I just want to make it clear that this is only for seniors of limited incomes. Other exemptions that do have annual requirements for renewal, such as the nonprofit exemptions and the agricultural exemptions, still have to be submitted by March 1st. We're not clearing them of their responsibility for exemption for submitting their exemptions. Just want to make that clear. It's just for the seniors.
Okay. Thank you, Catherine. Any comments from members of the public?
I'd like to make a comment of Sam Bussell concerning the presentation that four of us made the town board meeting last year, I guess it was, about the comprehensive plan and the relationship of zoning and a steering committee that had been recommended by our consultant, Nan Stoltenberg. We submitted a written copy of that prior to this meeting. And I'm wondering in terms of a response, how we get a response in terms of whether or not it's accepted. The basis of it was to get the village more involved in the preparation of implementation of zoning or revisiting zoning, as well as getting a professional assistant. And I was recommending maybe the person who did the study for us, the comprehensive plan for us, to just revisit where we are, where we should be, what we could be doing, and in conjunction with what the village would like to do. So that's the sort of follow-up that I would like to see, because I do believe the ZRC is working very hard and they're doing very well in terms of the various specifics in a particular district. But the overarching goal to improve equity and balance and of income and such in the village and the town has not been addressed specifically. And I think with an overview of the person who put that together with some very, very sensitive and detailed recommendations, criticisms, and comments, we would benefit at this point to both join hands with the village as well as solicit help from Nan Stolzenberg for the ZRC as well as the town and the village together.
Okay. Thank you, Sam. Are there any other comments on this topic or any other topic? I would just respond by saying that that I have not had a chance to talk with the mayor, nor for that matter, actually, with members of the board. I will try to get together with board members in the next few weeks, and as well as with the village, and see what how they feel we would move forward on this. I have a number of feelings about committees and joint committees and how well they work or don't work, but I'm going to try and put those feelings aside and look at this with an open mind. So I appreciate your input.
Thanks, Chris. Is it not appropriate to have a discussion in a town board meeting of this issue?
This is a comment period for you and members of the public to give us comments.
Got it.
You know, I think we haven't had a chance to even talk about it amongst ourselves. I want to make sure that all of the board actually have copies of the proposal that you've made. I know you made it in more detail to me, just myself, but I have not had a chance to either in writing transmit that to the board. I'd like to be able to do that.
Great. Thank you.
Right. Are there any other comments from the public? If not, I would like then to give the supervisor's report concerning our finances. This is the really exciting part of the town board meeting, as you all know. I have a special abstract dated December 28th, 2021, totaling $10,870.53, broken down as follows. A fund, $2,264.49. DB fund, $8,606.04. I'd like a motion to approve the special abstract. I think that was John Midwood who made the motion and Ralph who seconded it. All in favor?
Aye.
Yeah. And opposed? Nay. Motion is approved. I have an abstract dated December 31, 2021. Totaling $55,868.52, broken down as follows. A fund, $15,850.59. B fund, $3,177.02. DB fund, $34,542.21. T and A2 escrow, $2,298.70. Could I have a motion to approve the abstract?
So moved.
Motion by Griff.
Second
by Ralph. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Motion is carried. I have an abstract dated January 13, 2022, totaling $44,470.03, broken down as follows. A fund, $31,145.40. B fund, $350. DP fund, $8,606.04. Water District SW1, $120. Payroll TNA, $248.59. Could I have a motion to approve the abstract?
So moved.
John?
Second.
Second by Griff. All in favor?
Aye.
Nays? Motion is approved. I have a budget adjustment. A fund, an expense increase of $6,321, less an expense decrease of $6,321, for a net of zero. For B fund, I have an expense increase of $751, less an expense decrease of $751, for a net of zero. And for DB fund, I have an expense increase of $5,000, less an expense decrease of $5,000. Could I have a motion to approve the budget adjustment?
So moved.
Ralph, second.
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 By Griff. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. The voucher committee for February 2022 is John Midwood and Lana Morrison. We have approval of minutes from previous meetings. Do we have minutes from previous meetings that have been distributed to the board? And Tilly, can you tell us which dates we have meetings to approve?
Okay, the first one could you approve is the regular meeting on December 9th, 2021.
Okay. I would like a motion to approve the meeting of December 9th, 2021. I would ask Griff to abstain as he was not on the board at that time. Could I have a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Motion by Ralph. Motion by Ralph, seconded by John Midwood. All in favor?
Aye.
Nays? Abstain? Griff abstains. Okay, yeah, the next one?
Is for the organizational meeting on January 2nd, 2022.
Okay, this is...
Actually, that was January, was that?
Third, January 3rd, I believe.
Sorry.
What is known, affectionately known as the reorg meeting.
Okay.
Anyway, the minutes of the reorg meeting have been distributed. Could I have a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
So moved.
Okay, motion by John, seconded by Griff. All in favor?
Aye.
And opposed? Those minutes are approved. I do not believe we need to have a meeting with council unless there's anything the council wants to bring to our attention.
Nope, I'm fine.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. I would, in that case, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion by John.
Second.
By Ralph. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And opposed? The motion is carried. The meeting is adjourned. Thank you all very much. Look forward to seeing you in February.
Bye-bye, all.
Stay warm.
Okay.